Welcome to NIOS Studio. I am Dr. Amrit G. Kumar. I am working as Associate Professor in the Department of Education of Central University of Kerala. Today, we will be discussing about the evolution of post-independence social science curriculum. The nature, how the post-independence social science curriculum looks like, and what are the factors that influence this post-independent social science curriculum, all will be discussed today. As we all know, independence is a responsibility. When we become independent from colonial rulers, it has become a great responsibility for the Indian society. That means that we have to manage our own affairs. We have to govern ourselves. We have to create necessary knowledge for our own purpose and our own needs. We have to develop skill base for a new democracy. Otherwise, democracy will be disturbed and chaos will be created. And we have to design our own education system. That was another important huge challenge for the Indian society. So all these were, in fact, a responsibility for the Indian society after independence. As we know, before independence, these all were done by the colonial powers. Since we enjoy independence, we have the responsibility to shoulder these responsibilities of Indian society to march our society towards a greater nation. India's independence was achieved after a prolonged struggle. You all know that. Our independence struggle was spanned over a great number of years, and our leaders, national leaders, have gained independence, have led our nation to independence after a prolonged struggle. The values that guided India's freedom struggle and the ideals for a new democracy found expression in the Constitution of India. While we frame our Constitution in 1950, we have included all the values and ideals that led our leaders during their freedom struggle. So it took a position, it has found its position, it has found its place in the Constitution of India. The new ideals of creating a just and egalitarian society and the values of liberty, equality, justice and fraternity came into direct conflict with many of India's long-held working relationships of domination and subordination, caste and gender perceptions and colonial experiences. We know in pre-independence period, we were under exploitation. So under exploitation, many of the noble values which we have included in our constitution, like liberty, equality, justice, fraternity, were not being able to be expressed or not being able to be consummated or personified in our system, in our daily life. So as we all know that many of our own systems like caste system, gender perceptions of our people were not compatible with principles of equality, justice, fraternity, etc. So India's independence was accompanied by a painful partition that saw thousands of human beings massacred in violent riots. This was painful part of our independence. Our sister country has got separated from us, and thereby they have formed a new country which has resulted in violent riots across the country. Partition, in fact, left long scars on the already fragile communal relations. So it doesn't mean that the communal riots was only during the partition. Even before it was there, British people were successful in providing or in deep-rooting a ruling which was based on divide and rule. So the communal issues were even before there in Indian society during the independence, even before during the independence. The challenge was to impart our younger generation necessary skills to participate in democratic functioning of the country, to develop leadership qualities and to inculcate values of a new social order. The younger generation, if they were not oriented towards the democratic values, what will happen in our nation is a big chaos. People will not abide by the rule and regulation. If people are not complying to the rules and regulations of the land, that will lead to a big problem in the society. This will certainly hamper our intellectual development, economic development, social development, and development in any other spheres. So we wanted to develop or create a society who knows the values of a democratic society. The University Education Commission, which has submitted its report in 1949 and which was formed in 1948, that means immediately after independence, recommended education as the University Education Commission, which was established in 1948, that is immediately after independence, recommended that education should acquaint our students with the social philosophy which will govern all social, educational, and economic institutions. So we have a social philosophy, and that social philosophy will govern all social, educational, and economic institutions. And our children in schools and colleges must know about and must understand about this social philosophy, which is an imperative condition for the successful movement of our nation to development. The University Education Commission also recommended for providing training for democracy, which is very essential for acquainting students with cultural heritage and for developing understanding of past and present. Another important commission was Secondary Education Commission, which has started functioning in 1952 and submitted its report in 1953. The Secondary Education Commission reiterated the same values of developing democratic citizenship and leadership which was mentioned by the University Education Commission. The Indian Education Commission, which came in 1964 and submitted its report in 1966, also felt that there was a need for educational revolution, an internal transformation to relate education to life, needs, and aspirations of the nation. The Commission observed that our education system is not directly relating itself to the life, needs, and aspirations of the nation. Hence, the Commission recommended a drastic change in our education system, which will help our students to relate education to their contemporary life, their needs, and their aspirations of an individual and as well as of the nation. It recommended, the Indian Education Commission recommended, strengthening of social and national integration and cultivating social, moral, and spiritual values as our goals of education. India formulated a comprehensive national policy on education in 1986. Even before 1986, we were having national policy on education. But 1986 policy has become so crucial because it was so comprehensive and it has a long-lasting effect on Indian system of education. The 1986 National Policy on Education reflects the nation's aspirations and values regarding education. The policy stated that the national system of education will be based on a national curricular framework which contains a common core along with other components that are flexible. So, the National Policy on Education proposed for a national curriculum framework which will provide a uniformity of the curriculum from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. And not a single curriculum, but more or less a uniform curriculum. It doesn't mean that we have to provide the same curriculum from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, but instead a common standard is needed. And that this common standard has to be ensured through a common curricular framework, a national curricular framework. The common core will include the history of India's freedom movement, the constitutional obligations, and other content essential to nurture a national identity. So, across the nation, we need a common core for the social science curriculum. So, that common core must be a history of India's freedom movement, the constitutional obligations of an individual towards the nation, and other content which are essential to nurture a national identity. Every individual should feel that I am an Indian, and I am proud Indian. Every individual should feel that I am an Indian and I am being proud of it. So this kind of a national identity also should be promoted through education, especially social science education. These elements will cut across subjects and will be designed to promote values such as India's common cultural heritage, egalitarianism, democracy and secularism, equality of the sexes, protection of the environment, removal of social barriers, observance of the small family norm, and inclination of the scientific temper. So, depending upon the changes in the society, we can see that these preferences will subject to change. Say, for example, population is an important issue, that population growth is an important issue that we face in our modern society. So, we need a system, an education system, which will orient our younger generation about the difficulties and the negative impacts of a growing population. So, similar to this, any kind of social issues, a social problem which we face today has to be addressed through our education system. All educational programs will be carried on in strict conformity with secular values. We know that our nation is a plural society. Different religions, different regions, different languages are characteristics of our society. We have Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Parsi, Sikhs, Jain, Buddha, and so many other religions. So we live all in a very harmonious way in spite of our religious differences. Hence, secular values are very important in our nation. So our younger generation has to be promoted. So our younger generation has to be taught secular values through our education system. These core values define the direction which the social science curriculum is expected to take. So our social values, which are enshrined in our constitution, will direct our social science curriculum towards its new ways. After independence, we faced a multitude of problems, plurality of problems. These problems include religious differences, linguistic differences, regional differences, regional imbalances, and different other issues which has emerged from different parts of our country. These issues again includes poverty, inequality, and so on. Tackling these problems became a national priority. Growing more food, eradicating illiteracy, containing explosive population of growth, and stopping the explosive population of growth, and holding the country together in face of mounting external and internal divisive forces demands as much attention as upholding the cherished ideals of our democratic ideals of our constitution. All these issues, therefore, forced their way into social sciences curriculum, and students were rightly sensitized to the concerns of the society in which they lived. So hence, in a word, we can say that what is part of social science curriculum in our modern Indian society are those problems that we face in our modern society are part of our modern social science curriculum. Hence, any issues that may come in future also will become part of our social science curriculum. So, in total or in conclusion, we can say that what we study in our social science curriculum are the problems that we face today and the problems that we may face today. So, with this, I conclude our discussion today. Thank you so much.